Good morning. On the back lawn in the Riverland, and I'm going to go for a little wander around.
This is not your professionally produced YouTube video. This is Steve wandering around the block in the Riverland. Going past the shade house where all the little seedlings are cared for. Just to give them a bit of extra resistance. 1 degree this morning, so almost frosty. That's why you need things like the little greenhouse and protect it from all the frost. And have it peer in. Just a few plants. Watering system up top. There's a few little plants out on the back table to be planted sort of in some sort of a scheme. Mum and Dad up here, that's the leftovers of the orchard. A few trees, some new graftings, newly grafted different types of fruit. Alright, let's go for lumber. So this is just sort of one side of the main part of the native plants that have been planted. A little bit closer. Old walnut tree. One of the few left after the orchard was chopped down, and where the orchards were and now starts over here, hundreds. This is just the back of it, and that's where the row starts proper. Hundreds of native plants of all different sorts. So generally what I've been told by Mum and Dad, the way they work is they have, say, a larger bush or a plant. There will be, so that's a top cover of this, I guess, top, the tree sort of size. And then you have like an undercover, like a little plants right here. Then you'll have like a larger tree, and underneath there will be something small that needs shade of other plants to survive. So you can wander around and you can see a huge variety of different gums and wattles and the things I don't even know the name for, banksias. Look down the row to the terribly bright sun where the rest of the fruit blocks start nearby for the next door. So you'll see some really beautiful plants here. Get down into the sun at my back so I can actually see down some of these rows without the glare of the sun running. And these are yet to fruit, yet to flower. Big tree. But we've got nice long rows where there's a watering system in place where it can be used, isn't necessarily, depending on the tree and what status it's at. So if you've got something that's very, very small, like here where it's covered by plastic and shade cloth, it's barely getting by, that might have a little bit of water. But once they're grown, they don't have as much, except maybe in the depths of summer. So we're walking along, birds everywhere. These are just the rows we're walking past. And you're seeing, it might be just a few, a few native plants along here. So we've gone past 5, 6, 7, 8 rows, and there's might be 100 plants along them. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So yeah, so there might be a couple of thousand different native species here. Some of them are spectacularly beautiful. This one is flowered, and somewhere along its flowering, they're starting to droop a little bit. If I bring Mum or Dad out here to tell you all the names of them, it'd be a lot more talking than just me wandering around with the camera. They know every species name, subspecies, how they fit into the ecosystem, how they grow together. So you've got different types of undercover, so a really low bush here, and then sort of a something smaller and more succulent. It's a little larger at the back. You've got larger bushes and smaller bushes growing together. Gums, wattles, eremophilas, things I don't even know the names of, as usual. No idea how many rows I've gone past. So we're getting to the newer planted things, so only 18 months old or whatnot. Only a few months old down here. And then the newer stuff, which is probably that back table, where there's a couple of plants here. It's got some water, you can see the ground's wet. And down in here is a tiny little native, which you may or may not be able to see, depending on how well the camera's behaving. Amongst all the weeds, you know, it's not a perfect sterile environment, there's weeds everywhere. Try and pull them out, the ones that are going to interfere with the natives. So you've got the black polypipe with water runners, which have all been stoppered, right? So as they need the water, they're unstoppered, they pop a little end on it. Another little native down the bottom. And they water them, and when they don't need water anymore, they just cap them off. And they use the minimum amount of water just to get them established. Do it sensibly. So you're looking along here, there's just a handful of plants all the way down to the end of the block, way down where the avocado grove is. These are some of the small ones. This one's not done very well. It's not survived winter by the looks of this. But yeah, next to it. Beautiful, beautiful native plants that have just starting to flower properly. Some people ask me about native plants for their town, for the town, for, you know, on the streets, what's suitable, what's not going to drop giant gum nuts, what's going to look good, what's not going to get into the trees. So there's 1,000 species plus here, 2,000 species, maybe more. For your garden, you know, what's going to look really good, the blue-gum-blue-grey sort of leaves, you know, beautiful things they have, what sort of gum nuts do they have, what sort of shoots are they going to have, flowers. Up here you can find pretty much everything where it's, how it's actually going to look when it's finished growing, a lot of them, or you know, the stuff that's still growing. But you can get an idea of what it's really going to look like. You know, it's not necessarily some tiny little bush like this. You know, some of these things get really, really large, especially if you're going to water them. It's not like the nursery where there's this tiny plant and isn't that beautiful. Some of these things are great big bushes. And so you get going, you know, only for a year or two, some of these. Not that old. And some of the stuff's, you know, more than that. So here's a, you know, really decorative sort of leaf type plant. Very succulent, sort of like a gum tree leaf, but thicker and more succulent. It's got like a white powder on it. You can see where its protective mechanisms. It smells like gum tree. Little pale white bush, soft leaves. Beautiful. And I could spend hours wandering around here, just taking Mum around and naming all the plants for you, and that will tell you where they, what sort of water they use, and when they grow, and when they flower, and what animals like them, or which bees. In this case, here we've got a bee here. Just dropped a whole bunch of flower petals. It's self-mulching. So you've got, here you've got pink flower, little ones, the bottle brush types growing through. There's another plant in the middle with the other red flowers all together. So they all grow up together like this. Some of them take longer to establish themselves, like here, maybe something's died or this is just growing very slowly. There's obviously a new one here that's being protected. And right down the bottom, which you probably can almost see, tiny little plant, protected by plastic and hessian, or shade cloth in this case. So as they go along and things don't survive, because that happens, mum and dad will just plant something else. That died, no worries. Pop something else in the ground, see how it goes. It's like, you know, beautiful ground cover here. Succulent. Really sort of rigid, succulent type leaf. You've got some flower buds there. No idea what colour they would be. It looks really, really nice. If you had a large area, you wanted something sort of succulent and interesting looking. That bush right next to it. Great big tree. Really interesting fronds. The birds love it. There's a little bird up on the top of the tree there, just a little family. Watching me, wondering what the hell I'm doing. You can see the house back over that way. Not everything succeeds. One's on the cusp of death. Gouged by something. They get kangaroos out on the block out here. Wallabies come out for a drink of water if they can find it, or feed on something. It's not fenced off. Different states of flowering here. Beautiful little pink baubles, and then the flower comes out. Bees love it, apparently. It smells nice. It's got lots of little bottle brush type plants. Sort of spiky but not dangerous type leaves. It's Australia, so the leaves are all adapted for warm weather. Surviving different levels of heat. The pale gum tree leaves with the ability to reflect excess sunlight and still live on. Wattle. Very nice wattle. Bit of a decent sized bush. Get some wattle honey out of this one. Here's some birds in the bushes. See the flower, and then before it's the flower, so it's in the middle of spring for them. Some of the block is a little difficult to get through. That's supposed to be the path there. Oh, have a look at this. Wow. See that from 20 metres away. Brilliant, brilliant blue. How vibrant in the ultraviolet must this be to attract birds and other things, insects? If it's that blue to our eyes, our pitiful human eyes. Absolutely amazing. Wow. A whole bunch of weeds growing up between it. It's beautiful orange. Something orange and flowering over here. That's really nice. Wow. So many colours in native plants. Their flowers. These are... Well, you hear the bees. I'm not allergic, so probably fairly safe. I'll just get the crap stung out of me. There's a rabbit. Hello, Mr. Rabbit. Gone. Don't think it was a hair looked off the rabbit. We made it to the road. The avocado farm across the road. There we go. Big sort of bottle brushes, Banksias. Are they Banksias? They're Banksias. Yeah, the little Banksia mouth. Or, how's this for a gum nut? So this is the sort of plant you don't put on a road if you like your pedestrians whole and hale, because these nuts will make a mess of the wheelchair or someone unsteady on their feet, small child or elderly person. You end up stopping on those, you're going to take a tumble. You need to take care of your people. But at home, you can have one of those, and that grows up. That'd be amazing. Obviously, this gum tree here is hasn't flowered yet. So those clusters of buds would be an amazing display once it flowers. Let's trek through the bushes. See what else we can find. It's a little ground cover. Light coloured. Don't know what it is. You could probably spend 2 months with little plaques out here just going around with mum and dad and labelling everything one by one and them arguing over which particular subspecies it is. Excuse me. Oh, hello. They weren't expecting me, I wasn't expecting them. Gone. All right, coming back to the house. This is some of the older growth. This has been around for a lot more years, and you've got some really decent sized trees in there and some really heavily grown out ground cover. It's like this impenetrable forest of different things. I might be able to get through there, but I'm just going to go around. Tiny, tiny, tiny little flowers, but lots and lots and lots of them. If you know what colours everything produces, like I'm about to, you could actually prepare like a particular colour scheme for your yard. If you want something that is beautiful, royal sort of purple colour, and then sort of understated because there's small flowers on a larger bush, you do this. You can go to the great big Banksia route with beautiful, you know, orange, red, yellow tipped bees. Absolutely love it. So not for those of you who are allergic, don't have these around if you don't want bees everywhere by the looks of this. You've got violet and sort of maroon coloured, blue and red mixed. Oh, great big leafy trees. That's a bit of my hand. Yeah, pretty much. Big, big leafy beanpole trees. Right, making it back to the back lawn. See the walnut tree in the distance there. The pool, which is filled with the dirt, and there's a lovely little garden bed now. Pools take time to maintain, and you've got several thousand native plants, perhaps you don't have time to maintain a pool, or you don't want to. Here's our start point. Alright, well, back in time for a cup of tea for me.